Good evening, everyone. Welcome to the book club for this Sunday's session. Now, we are very, very proud to have with us Sai Paranjpye. Now, you know, very often an introduction begins by saying she doesn't need any introduction. But today's speaker truly does not. So this icon of Indian cinema is with us today. And Sai, thank you so much for taking the time to come here. We are so happy to have you.
My pleasure.
We have two people in conversation with Sai to talk about the new book of memoirs that has come out. It's called A Patchwork Quilt. And Sai will be talking to Latika Padgaukar and Aneeta Benninger. Now, Latika, of course, many of you have seen before. You've seen her presenting. You know that she's a lover of literature and cinema. And Aneeta Benninger is a town planner of repute and also a connoisseur of the arts. So we have two very able people to be in conversation with Sai so that we can find out more about her. Now, all I can say right now is she is such a multifaceted personality that if you thought you knew a lot about her, you're going to find that you knew very little about her because there's so much more to know. So without further ado, because there's a lot to say, so let's get the show started. So Latika and Aneeta, please take over. Sai, welcome.
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
And 1 minute, everyone else, please mute yourself. Okay, go ahead now.
Okay, so good evening to everybody, and thank you for requesting Aneeta and me to be in dialogue with Sai Paranjpye. I can't tell you how happy we are, because we've both been involved in the book in one way or the other.
Please start
good
again.
Evening, everybody. Good evening, all my book club friends. Aneeta and I are absolutely delighted to have our old friend with us, Sai Paranjpye, our very own. She is, as you know, a film and theatre director and a writer. And she's also Padma Bhushan awardee. You have all the awards there. So she's a multiple award winner and an absolute household name in Maharashtra. So Saital, how does one really begin introducing you? You've had an extraordinarily rich and a very creative life in many, many different fields. Many people would know you as the author and the maker of films such as Sparsh, which has won many awards, including National Film Awards, Chashme Baddu, Rangutha Chaap, Katha, Disha, Papiha, in a lot of films, and a lot of in documentaries also, and TV series. You have also worked as a director and writer, not just of Marathi plays, but you've written plays in Hindi and English too, and not just for adults, but for children also. And these plays have won awards both at the national level as well as at the state level. And you have worked with the Children's Film Society of India, which you have headed actually twice. So this is just the most elementary introduction to you. We will discover you as we speak more and more during this program. I would request Aneeta to take over and talk to Sai about something very important in her life, which is right from the beginning, the role her family played and her Russian family. I would like to ask Aneeta to take over.
Thank you, Latika. Saitai,
yeah.
You grew up in a unique household. Your grandfather, R.P. Paranjpye, was India's first senior wrangler. Yeah. Your mother, Shakuntala Paranjpye, Shakutai, held a typos, lived abroad, worked abroad. She was an exceptional progressive person who worked in family planning and women's emancipation long before anybody else's time. It was not
at a time when the word family planning was not mentioned in polite society.
Right. So she was a pathbreaker, actually a pioneer in work. And so she had multiple, what shall I say? She was a Rajya Sabha member. She was a Vidhan Sabha member. She was a member of, she was a Padma Bhushan, all of those things. But she was exacting where you were concerned. That is what you keep saying. and wanted you to excel in everything, dancing, swimming, sportsmanship, music, everything. How did this impact your personality and career?
Well, I often said to her that she was a dictator, a benevolent dictator maybe, but a dictator nonetheless. And at times my childhood was really miserable because I was made to do all kinds of extraordinary and impossible things, like singing, for example. Now, she thought that I must, you know, not only know everything, every branch of art, everything going that is to be learned, I have to learn it. And not only learn it, but excel at it. Now, this was humanly impossible for anyone, let alone a child just growing up. So I was given music tuitions by a person no less than Mirashi Bua, himself a very renowned musician and singer, vocalist in Pune. And he won the Sangeet Natak Academy Award, but Bua would come every day. And I must have been 6 years old, I think. And we never went beyond Rag Asawari. And I remember I used to sit on the bed, cross-legged, Bua with his Tanpura singing. And he would sing and I would listen and I would peep down to see, I forget the technical word for it, but the little tongue, you know, at the back. And I would, I would see that. And finally, after a year or so of singing Asawari, or not singing Asawari, he, Bua said with folded hands to my mother, Shakuntala Bai, Sai doesn't have an iota of talent where singing is concerned. So please spare her and spare me so my can stop. But apart from that, jokes apart, she really was responsible for whatever little I've been able to achieve in my lifetime. She was truly the person who egged me on, who nurtured me, who bullied me, who cajoled me, who encouraged me, everything. And in everything I have done, I like to say that you can see her footprints, you know, you can see her. She made me write, and my first book was published when I was 8 years old. Now, that's not because I was exceptionally talented or anything, but it's because I had an extraordinary mother, you know, who recognized some kind of a talent in me and who nurtured it. And she, it began, I'll tell you how, she used to tell me bedtime stories. And one day she said, now today I've run out of stories. You tell me a story for a change. I said, okay. So I did. I told her some fancy story with about kings and queens. And I remember there was a sadhu with a blue beard. So she heard the tale and she said, not bad. Who told it to you? I didn't. I said, nobody did. I made it up. She said, nonsense. Tell me another one. So I told her another one. And when she was convinced that the stories really did come from me, because I used to read a hell of a lot. And then that was my undoing. Because from that day onwards, I had to write at least 3 pages every day about something, a story or an essay or my experience or what happened at school, whatever. And until I wrote those 3 pages, I was not allowed to go out to play. So it was quite taxing, to say the least. And also I would be spanked good and proper. You know, she was very strict, very loving. And at the same time, she was a bipolar personality, I can say. You know, she has strictness, also knew no bounds. And I would get thoroughly spanked almost every other day for things that I did or did not do. So, and in our neighborhood, parents often told their children, they said, you better behave or you'll get spanked like Sai, you know. And when I heard that, my ears would burn. I would feel so humiliated. But on the other side, she was so loving and caring, and her world literally centered in me. And when I was a kid, we used to have dolls' weddings, as you must know. It was the thing of the time, you know. Every child, every girl especially, had a doll, and she had to get married with the time came. So my doll, unfortunately, never got married because mommy didn't believe in such foolishness. She said, nonsense, you can't have dolls' weddings and so on. So I would go everywhere, I'd be invited, but I could never invite anyone back. And that would upset me no end. And finally, I think I threw a tantrum, and finally mommy relented and she said, okay, come on, we'll have a doll's wedding. And Aneeta, the wedding we had was so lavish, I can't tell you. We had a proper scout band with 18-year-old boys in pink turbans and a real white horse, a beautiful horse decked up in all kinds of jewelry. And then we had peras, and we had our house or the garden teeming with children, invited and uninvited, and swarming all over the place, and peras for everyone. And then we took the barat, my doll and her groom, on the little white horse. And we went down up the road and across, and then back again, Ferguson College Road, and back to the house. And such was the wedding, lavish absolutely, that people talk about it, those who attended, even today. So that was, you know, the kind of, but she taught me Sanskrit shlokas. And though we, our household was agnostic, or I can even say atheist, my grandfather was an atheist, so was my mother. So there weren't any gods and no puja or nothing like that. But stotras, yes, I had to learn all the stotras. I knew the Ravana stotra, Ram Raksha, of course, and Shiva stotra and Devi stotras and all the stotras. And I would rattle them off with great gusto, you know, because I always had this drama thing in me, love to sort of overact and overdo everything. So I knew a lot of stotras, and she would write shlokas with me, you know, Sanskrit shlokas. And Sanskrit is so full of, apart from the wisdom that it contains, it has such a lot of humor, you know. And so they like that. And then I was taught to write, of course, and to read. Do you know, I had read Dickens and Jane Eyre and Scott and all the Monte Cristo stories and Three Musketeers and the kind of books that I'm, Thomas Hardy. I read all these before I was 12 years old. And alongside, I also read the Marathi classics like Sane Guruji and Lakshmi Bai Tilak and all the Marathi books that were available. And so my reading was really spot on. And apart from mother, my grandfather, the great mathematician, Wrangler R.P. Paranjpye, unfortunately did not pass on his genes, which enable you to be a fantastic mathematician. That did not come to me. But he did very lovingly open the world of Hans Christian Andersen and Grimm's fairy tales and so on. And every morning we would go for a walk down the canal. We had this lovely canal in those days, developed into what I did, and enjoyed doing it.
Okay, Saitei, what about your father's family?
My father's family. Well, perhaps you have heard that my father was a white Russian, and my grandfather, Papa's father, my father, Yuroslavtsov, and his father was a general in the Tsar's army. They were white Russians. And my grandfather died during the revolution, and he died fighting. And then my grandmama, Babushka, I called her, she took little Yura, that is my father, who must have been, I think, 2-3 years old, whatever. She took him, and they, like so many other white Russians, they crossed across Europe, and they came either to France or Switzerland. And Babushka came to Switzerland, Geneva, with little Yura tagging along. And then she learned nursing. And do you know, Babushka was an actress.
I think Sai has had what she calls, she has meandered through a magical labyrinth. She calls her meanderings in radio, television, children's theater movement, books, documentaries, teleserials, telefilms, feature films, and whatnot. It's a magical labyrinth. And I suppose that is why her book has been called A Patchwork Quilt. It's really a patchwork of many different activities, many different paths that she has tread. But what I would like to say here quickly before she continues speaking about her career and her memoirs, I would just like to say that hats off to Sai's absolutely prodigious memory, you know, and her very, very acute sense of recall, which goes all the way back to her childhood days. I mean, I can't recall what happened yesterday, and she's recalling with such clarity what happened to her when she was a little girl. So I don't think everyone is quite so blessed as she is in this regard, definitely. I know that Sai began her career with All India Radio, and it's quite interesting, and it also tells us a little bit. Can Sai hear this?
Yeah, begin here. Okay.
So Sai, you did begin your career at All India Radio. I want to ask you how you stepped into All India Radio, whether it was Marathi. He speaks about All India Radio, because we are going to ask her later on what are how she actually got inspired, and was it in a flash or was it something that grew in her little by little? And she gives us this very, very interesting little episode that she used to go to All India Radio, wherever the headquarters were in Pune. Now I think they are in Shivaji Nagar. I don't know where they were earlier. She used to take a bus or maybe two buses. And when she used to come back, she used to think about what happened in the day and get inspired to write, and then completely forget to get off at the bus stop where she needed to get off. And she didn't have paper on her. And she used to take the bus tickets that she had bought that day and earlier days and start penning down what was inspirational to her and what eventually could take her further in either her performance on All India Radio or teleserials or whatever, which were to come later. Sai, can you hear me now?
See you yet.
Could you ask me the question again?
Because I can ask you the question, Sai. I'm asking you about your first foray into the media world, and it was with All India Radio in Pune. So can you tell us how you managed to get into All India Radio? What I took will. You there? Who took you there? And yeah, what work yes. you did there?
I will. Okay. My BA exam was fast approaching. Okay. And I was studying at long last. Grappling with logic, in fact. And suddenly, out of the blue, a khaki-clad spoon came to the door, and he said, is any Paranjpye here? There's a letter for her. So I was handed this brown envelope. And it was an invitation to go to... I don't study in the evening in any case. So just go and find out what it's all about. So I did exactly that. I landed up at the studio and I was given 2-3 printed pages of some announcements. And I was told that when you enter the studio and when the red light is on, you start reading. So I said, fine. And I went in. And I remember even today that the text, it was Marathi. It was it had a line saying, Dhagancha gargadata sah vizancha kadkadatu. So now I was reared on Sanskrit and I could recite the Tandav Stotra Jata Kataha Brahmani Limpanirjari by heart. So this Gargadat Karkarat didn't faze me. And I read with aplomb. I have a bit of drama in me anyway. So I think I read with full confidence. And by the time I finished and the red light turned to green, I reached for the door, a huge heavy door, pulled with all my might. The duty officer was standing outside. He said, join from tomorrow. I can't. I've got my exam around the corner. I can't join from tomorrow. He said, oh. And so I said, very sorry, my loss, et cetera, said the right things. And I marched off. And when I reached the gate, another duty officer said, for tomorrow, he said, this is only in the evening. You should read it for 5 minutes and then go off. It's not a whole day.
You were the anchor for Balutya, right?
Yeah.
So can you tell us about one of your first attempts at scripting and directing a movie, like Pedu Kwadi?
No, let me first explain what Balutyan is for those who don't know. Balutyan was the program for children when I joined the radio. And it used to be for 1 hour every Sunday. And then also on every Wednesday for about half an hour or so. So I was the compere along with Nana of Balodhyan. And it was a wonderful experience talking to children and, sort of presenting all kinds of items that they would love and cherish and, they'd be interested in. And so we were quite a team. And in those days, you must remember, there was no television. So radio people were the stars of the day. And so as the Tai of Malodhyan, or the Didi, or the older sister, as I was called, it was quite fantastic to have a kid brigade follow you around and you to be recognized in the streets, Tai, Tai, and so on. Yeah, it felt quite good. So that was my first taste of, what shall I say, publicity or being recognized, being known. And apart from that, it was a very challenging and a very exciting program and time, because you got to invent all kinds of things, find out new talent, present new items. And I gradually started to produce programs, and Nana got me to produce my first venture ever. It was called Bedu Kwadi, and it was a lovely little play, I'm sorry, not play, book written by Nagar Gore, the socialist and the leader and the social worker. So Nagar Gore had written this delightful storybook for children called Bedu Kwadi. It was about the doings of a little tadpole. You know, he goes to school and he meets all the water creatures on his way, our route, and he has a few scraps with various people. He meets snakes and eels and lots of fish and so on. And it was so delightfully written that I said to Nana, we must make a radio play out of this. He said, can you do a radio play? I said, I'll try. And I did. And he said, first, we have to take permission from Nagar Gore. And Nagar Gore, who's also my mother's friend since they worked together in the social field, he was very delighted. He said, of course, certainly do whatever you want with it. And then I did exactly that. And it was a one-hour-long play, which was quite ambitious for those days. And I got Ram Kadam, who became a music director in his own right later and gave very lovely music for Marathi films. So Ram Kadam was on our staff. He was the staff clarinet player and a delightful, mischievous guy. And he and I were great friends. And I said, Ram, would you like to give the music for this? He said, of course. I mean, a true-blooded musician. So
Sai did go to the National School of Drama. She attended that in Delhi. And that was at the time when Ibrahim Al-Kazi was the head of the National School of Drama. And Al-Kazi brought a phenomenal change in the way one looked at theatre. And I think he left a lasting impression on Sai. She was very, very influenced by the way he looked at, particularly he opened up the world of Western theatre to all his students. That was one thing that she really wanted to highlight in her book. The other thing that she wanted to highlight was her stint at the Film and Television Institute of India. She went there and for some time, she taught theory and technique of acting, voice training, and speech. And she had some very brilliant students who went on to, you know, become a name in Indian cinema in one way or the other, whether it was Sadhu Meher or Jalal Agha, and who acted in, you know, landmark films like Ankur and Bhuvan Shom and so on. And I think this in some way did prepare her for her future work in cinema. Now, what Sai did, which Aneeta would have asked her in great detail, is not only did she go into Doordarshan, not only did she become the producer, but she also handled the first inaugural program of Bombay Television. Now, that she regards really as one of the highlights of her career, her what she did to start this absolutely magical and, you know, very, very ornate first Bombay television show. She also spent some time in the Children's Film Society of India. She later on went on to become the head of it, not once, but twice. So I would have liked to have asked her, for the sake of our audience, what her experience was there as the head of CFSI, and what she was able to achieve and in what direction she took it. Normally, Sai, can you hear me? No, you cannot. You can? Okay. So would you like to speak about, I can't hear you at all.
Oh.
Now you're okay. So would you like to speak about your stint at Children's Film Society of India?
It's a major jump, Latika, you know.
You went first once and then you went later on as the head.
Once I went from, this was after my stint at television as a producer.
Yes.
So, you know, I feel it's very disjointed. I don't want to talk about CFSI just now. I feel
okay, take it. Then maybe we can turn to, because, you know, we did go through your stint at National School of Drama. We went because we couldn't hear you at all. You want to speak about that? National School of Drama and Al-Qazi? And
so I'd like to talk about, if I may,
sure.
my experience with children in All India Radio first, you know, and then how that led to my work for with the children in the children's theater, how I started that movement. That also would be very important.
Go ahead.
I'd like to talk about that. Okay. Well, you heard about, could you hear about Bedupadi, what I talked
yes,
about?
Yes, we did. We did. Okay.
So after Bedupadi, it was a huge success. I really got pumped up and I said, now I should write my own stuff. You know, I had, and as I told you, I'd started writing at a very, very early age, at the age of 8. So I was already a writer, knew how to write. So I wrote my very first play for children. It was called Pakshanti Kavi Sammelan. I later translated it and it was called Bards of a Feather. Bard as in Shakespeare, B-A-R-D. Instead of Birds of a Feather, Bards of a Feather. And it was, as the name suggests, it was about a poetry program which all the birds decide to have and they want to decide who is the best of the lot. It's a So this play was again very successful and was performed in the radio week, which we had in those days. And in the radio week, it was presented on the stage and the children did a very splendid job. And that play was so successful that after that, I wrote a spate of plays like Shepti Sasha, Bhatkache Bhavishya, Patte Nagrit, and so on. I wrote at least 6-7 plays, and they were all performed for the radio weeks or for Balodhyan. And they became so successful, and the children loved doing them, performing. But what would happen is that the radio week show would be just one show a year. So after a big rehearsal, the children would be told that, well, okay, this is it. We've had our show and thank you very much. And they would be so disappointed that all our work, all our excitement, and just one show, even the parents were slightly disillusioned. And so we had an idea, my friend and I, and we said, why don't we start a children's theater movement, you know, and produce these plays elsewhere, apart from radio, because radio can give us only a platform for one day. That's not enough. We must go out and have and teach these children, groom them, and present these plays all over the place. So this is exactly what we did. And the children's theater movement became, again, very, very successful. We did plays there, about 6-7 various plays. And then, you know, while we were, I incidentally got married during this time because Arun Dubekar and I, he was also a secretary along with me in the children's theater. And we decided we liked the same thing. We had the same passion. We got married. And at that time, we came across an announcement in the papers, in the press, inviting students from all over India to apply for the National School of Drama entrance exam, you know. And, to me, it sounded very exciting. I said, wow, teaching theater, because by now I had decided that theater is what I'm going to do. And I said, it's wonderful. But by that time, I'd been married exactly for 1 month. I said, it might seem a little ridiculous if after just 1 month of married life, I trot across, that school was in Delhi, trot over to Delhi, and what are people going to say, and what am I going to feel, and so on. But Arun was very sporting. He said, no, this chance may never come again. You grab it while you can, and, you know, never mind about, we'll work something out, but go and give the audition anyway, and whether you want to join or no is comes later, but at least go and give the audition and give the exam. And who knows, maybe you'll fail. You may not even be selected. Look at the bright side, you know, you're a very wicked sense of humor. So, but anyway, I was selected and I did join the School of Drama. And then after 1 year of doing practically nothing there, nothing much was happening. But the next year, an avalanche in the form of Mr. Ibrahim Al-Qazi took shape. And he descended on the scene and we had a fantastic time learning from this great guru of theater, this great thespian, this great person. I mean, I have not enough words to describe his talent and his reach and his scholarship and his knowledge. It was marvelous. And not only theater, he was an expert on impressionist art and the literature of Europe and so on. It was really marvelous. And he was such a perfectionist that everything had to be just so. And what we learned, apart from seeing fabulous works of his during those days, but we learned the idea of discipline, which is very sadly lacking, alas, even today in our theater, especially in Maharashtra. I'm very sorry to say that, but it's something that is lacking. And Al-Qazi taught us the importance of discipline. And the plays that he produced Andhayug in the fort of Purana Killa, you know. And you can imagine, you know, the forts and the tumble down rocks and the broken ruins and the atmosphere that it generated. It was just mind blowing. And you literally had goose flesh when you were seeing these plays. And Arun later joined a year later and he played the role of Ashwatthama in a play called Andhayug, which again was staged at Purana Killa. So it was a mesmerizing experience. And I can't thank the man upstairs enough for giving me this opportunity.
Okay, Sai, we do want to come to your, your theater cinema work first. So I would like to proceed to your cinema work. But before that, before cinema came all your plays. And here I would request Aneeta to take over, ask her about her different plays, ask her about, you know, whether Tamasha, Review, Natyadvai and so on. So Aneeta, can you ask her that? I'll take over for cinema. Yeah.
Okay, thanks, Latika. Saitai, you worked with the Doordarshan from its inception, right?
Yes, yes, that's right. I was one of the first producers of Doordarshan when it started. There were six of us.
And you did the Bombay Doordarshan, the first one.
The inaugural program, right? You produced that. Especially called from Delhi. Hello? And that was a major feather in my cap, obviously. And it was fantastic being specially invited from Delhi to go and produce the very first program of Bombay Doordarshan. And I like to say, mother of Bombay Doordarshan, of course, jokingly. And every time I look at the transfer, I feel, something really takes over and I feel so proud and so happy. It was wonderful.
It is your first love, theater, right? And tell us about Natyadvai, which you started with Arun Dada.
Well, rather a fancy name, Natyadvai. We thought it was ever so grand, but now I think it's quite silly. But anyway, we had this, and both of us were
on a Zoom call with Sai Paranjpye.
What's happening? I can hear.
Continue.
Latika, why are you interrupting?
No.
Okay, shall I carry on? Okay, so Arun and I did theater. I was working in Doordarshan and Arun was working somewhere in Delhi. This is after our NSD, we passed out. And I remember we did a lot of plays in Marathi in Delhi. And we did Vijay Tendulkar's Sakharam Baider, we did Maheshanko Velukutswat's Vasana Khan, we did P.L. Deshpande's Vittalato Alala, etc. And then what we realized was that after a time, the Marathi audience petered out because there were only so many people, theater-going people in Delhi. at that time. And they came in droves. They came in large numbers for the first three or four shows. And after that, the audience just finished. They'd seen it. So again, we said, now what do we do? I mean, all that effort, all that expenditure, all that energy, just for four shows, it wasn't working out. So what we started doing was, that I think it was a very good idea, we started doing Hindi adaptations of good Marathi plays. Like we did Sakharam Binder in Hindi, we did Astakhan, we did this, that, all kinds of very well-known plays. We even did Chekhov's, not that he's a Marathi playwright, but Chekhov's Inspector Calls, we did that. Called Ji Huzur, and that was again a lovely production. And and we did that. I even did a Punjabi play, believe it or not, and that was so hilarious, you know, because I didn't speak Punjabi, but of course one learned got the nuances right and so on. And we had lots of Punjabi friends. And I remember in doing that, we did Chakka Chaldae, which was two Veda Kumbhar in Marathi, Venkatesh Vadgulkar's play, and it adapted so exquisitely to the Punjabi soil, you know, the whole ambience and the whole, the theme and the people and the way of thinking and the social situation, everything was so akin to what was happening in Punjab that it worked beautifully. But every 5 or 6 days during rehearsal, a fight would flare up in the amongst the actors. Because, you see, one actor was from Ludhiana, another from Amritsar, another from Jalandhar, and so on and so forth, you know, different places with different dialects and with different figures of speech and different styles of speaking and so on. And they would fight and they would say that their way of saying a particular dialogue was correct. And obviously, no other person is going to accept that. So there would be a fight. And of course, I, being a poor Marathi girl from Pune, couldn't take part in that. So I would meekly sit in the corner, and someone came for our rehearsal and said, Sai, this is the tamest I've ever seen you, you know, during your own rehearsal, you know, you're sitting so quiet. How do I fight with these Punjabi militants, you know? So anyway, but it was such fun doing that, and it worked very well, and it added to our repertoire, it added to our experience, it added to our everything, stocking.
Tell us something about your tamashas and reviews. What is the difference?
Reviews. Well, when I was in France on a French government scholarship for a year, I saw very many reviews on the left bank, you know. Now, a review is a kind of an informal presentation. I won't call it a play because there's no coherent storyline running through the thing. But they have a theme usually, and around that theme, little skits and little scenes and little songs and whatever are woven around that theme and presented. And it's all very light-hearted and fun and terrific repartee. And obviously the actors have to be superb. And it is a merry thing altogether. Absolutely a very jolly kind of a theater experience. And it was so wonderful. So when, as a theater scholar in Paris, I would see Ionesco and obviously Shakespeare and Shaw and Audi and Genet and so on. And after these heavy doses of very serious theater, I would once in a way turn to the reviews on the left bank just to relax. And I found them so exhilarating and so funny. And then I realized that they are not so different from our tamasha, except, as you said, the difference between the review and the tamasha. I would say I was struck by the similarity between the two forms. Now, the tamasha is also informal, you know. It just runs across, it skips across merrily along and takes the audience with it. And there's so much nonsense in it, but it's such delightful nonsense that you get carried away. And it is so beautiful, except that tamasha is from the soil, and it is presented by our poor illiterate brethren who villages and make, you know, this their livelihood. But what brilliant actors there are in the Tamasha field, and what fantastic shows I've seen. And, you know, similarly, the review, but the review being French, is la-di-da and very sophisticated and very just so, and very, and the production quality obviously is much more superior. And, but ultimately, these are twins separated at birth, one to become Don and the other to become a police inspector or whatever, you know, the we are so used to the story of the twins being separated. So I feel that the Tamasha and the review are really very akin to each other. And I decided that I would try a Tamasha when I return back to base, to India. And I would also try a review, which I did. I, as I said, usually a theme. And the first theme that I chose was marriage, you know, marital, state of marital bliss or whatever. So, and the play, the review was called Nanda Saukhya Bhare, which, you know, when people get married, when a young couple gets married and they sort of bend down to touch the feet of the elders say, Nanda Saukhya Bhare, live happily ever after, you know. So that was the name. And there were skits, and Arun and I acted in that along with two very other talented people, Daya Dongre and one Vishwas Mehendale. And this took Delhi by storm, and we were invited to Bombay and Pune and so on. So we had very many shows of this Nanda Saukhya Bhare. This was followed by another review that I wrote. It was called Sathe Shezari, Neighbors. It was, the theme was neighborly love, love thy neighbor. And again, you know, lots of the gives and takes and the animosities and the friendships and the affairs and all that of neighbors, little skits. And again, that was that, I think, ran for more than 500 shows in Maharashtra, which was quite a feat at that time. And then it was done, all of it was done in America, it was done in Holland, and it was done in quite a few places. And that again was a very merry experience.
Sai, can we now turn to cinema? Because I think we have little time left and we want to speak about your four films and give...
Sure, sure, certainly.
Okay. Yeah, so I'd like to turn to your first film, Sparsh. And in this film, you have as your protagonist, Nasiruddin Shah, who is blind. So I would like to say one thing. Can you tell us a little bit about the world of the blind as you...
Tell you how it started quickly. See, well, I was a producer with Delhi Doordarshan, and my boss, one Mr. S.N. Murthy, who was the station director, he called me. He said, Sai, the World Handicap Day is around the corner in about a week or so. So I want you to go to the Blind Institute here, Blind School, Blind Relief Association it was called, and do a documentary of their daily activities, you know, something, rustle something up on there, which gives us an idea of what they do during the day. And a short documentary. So I quaked. So I said, oh, the blind school, please, sir, don't send me there. He said, oh, why not? I said, I have a thing about the blind. I can't bear to see blind people and children. You know, I feel terribly, I just feel very sorry, and I can't take it, and I want to cry, and I want to this, blah, blah, blah. A lot of sentimental nonsense, I think I spun out. And Mr. Murthy, very strict person that he was, and a very lovely man, he said, ha-ha, so you are too agile, huh? And you don't want to go to the blind school because it will make you cry. He said, and you are the one who's always fighting with me for not giving you plum assignments, always giving in the better assignments, and you being a woman, being given substandard stuff, so to speak, and you're always cribbing, and now I give you something and you're telling me that you're too soft-hearted to tackle it. You be a professional, go and do your job, and you jolly well give me a decent 10-minute documentary at the end of it. Right, I went, and I stood quaking at the gate, and I looked in, and what do I see? On the lawn, it's a beautiful place, you know, lovely building with the lawn and so on, flowers and so on. So I saw about 12 children, you know, six on either side, pulling at a rope, you know. They were playing tug of war, and they were pulling and pushing and screaming and laughing, and they were having a whale of a time. And I stood mesmerized at the gate, And I said, what am I seeing? These are not poor little blind children. They're having fun. They're ordinary children, except they can't see. I mean, yes, but otherwise they're perfectly normal. And then they were fighting there, you know. And then I went and I met the principal of the school, BRA. He was called Mr. Mittal, Ajay Mittal. I met him, a dynamic man. He too was blind. He was, I believe, a Wisconsin PhD, returned to Delhi to take on the school. And what a dynamic person. He spoke fantastic Hindi and wonderful English, and he was very eloquent, and he introduced me to his children, and the atmosphere was of such happiness and such, what should I say, such wanting to do something. It was a very ambitious kind of a place there, you know. It was, but people were bent on doing things. They were all very charged. It was, the atmosphere was electric. It was charged. So I was so, so inspired. I did that little documentary, whatever. But that visit stayed with me. And I wrote a teleplay. I called it Raina Beet Jaye, The Night Will Pass. And it was about a love affair between a blind person and a woman who is a widow, who she's just lost her husband 2 years back, and she is in a cocoon of misery, not refusing to come out of it, and how she lands in the school to teach blind children sing songs and so on, and how they fall in love, etc., etc., love story. So I wrote that, and again, it was fantastically successful. People loved it. There were at least 6 repetitions, but unfortunately, I was very sad because the blind children, I couldn't accommodate them. I couldn't show their activities. I couldn't really use them in the script, in the screenplay. So I wrote a major screenplay, a proper Hindi film screenplay of more than nearly 2 hours. And I said, I'm going to make a feature film of this at some point or the other. Such was my conviction and my ambition. But I wrote that and kept it aside, continued with television. And then finally that film ultimately did become Sparsh, and it won these awards, and it got fabulous actors like Naseer and Shamana. And I was able to show the blind children. And we shot in the Blind Relief Association school, and we shot with actual blind children. And what a fantastic cast they were, I can't tell you. And we, when Sparsh was taken to Beijing, I remember the huge hoarding on the Beijing theater, you know. And I said, I can't believe this can't be happening. And the letters Sparsh in Chinese lettering. So it was fantastic. And when we went in, and the ovation that the blind children got from the Chinese audience was something fantastic. So I think it was really worthwhile doing.
Should we see a small clip from this film?
Why not? I'll quickly give you the backdrop. This is when Naseer and Shabana, Naseer is with, they've fallen in love, and they're going to get married. And this is their first outing, and they are, you know, talking romantic talk. Let's hear them.
Yes. Yes, Mushroom.
सोच रहा हूँ तुम कितनी सुंदर हो.
कैसे मालूम?
नहीं हो क्या? सच सच बताओ.
हाँ हूँ. कहते हैं.
तो क्यों कहते हैं? जो कहते हैं?
क्योंकि मेरी आँखें बड़ी हैं और भूरी. मेरे बाल घने हैं, मेरे होंठ और मेरा रंग गोरा है. सुंदर कहलाने के लिए हमारे देश में ये काफी है.
नहीं, इतना काफी नहीं है. मेरे लिए तो ये बेकार खट्टे अंगूर. पता है तुम मुझे सुंदर क्यों लगती हो?
क्यों?
इसलिए कि तुम्हारे बदन की, बालों की महक लुभावनी है, इसलिए तुम सुंदर हो. निशी गंधा के फूल की तरह।
अच्छा,
और तुम्हारी आवाज भावस्पर्शी है, इसीलिए तुम सुंदर सितार की झंकार की तरह, और तुम्हारा स्पर्श बहुत कोमल है, इसलिए तुम सुंदर हो मखमल की तरह, और इस सबसे ज्यादा तुम्हारा पन जो है।
बस 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 बदहजमी हो जाएगी।
Yeah.
So
that was beautiful.
Thank you.
Just want to ask, you know, because I do have questions on each of these films, most of them, not all of them, of course. How much time do we have? Because, you know, we wanted to her to talk about Disha and Katha and, you know, do we have time for all of them? Papiha?
20 minutes.
Okay. So, if you go to the next cult film, your cult film, Chashme Baddu. I think it's a film which was really very widely seen, light-hearted film. Would you like to speak about this one and why it became a cult film? And then we can have a little, you know, fun clip out of this film. Why it became a cult film?
Yeah. Well, after the success of Sparsh, after the awards and the major press write-ups and so on, I was invited to Moscow. I had gone to Moscow, the Moscow Film Festival, Sparsh, and I met Gul Anand there. He was a major distributor of foreign films in India. He would, especially Russian films, he would get them and dub them in Hindi and distribute them all over the place. So he was a well-known figure in the distribution circles, in the film circles of Russia. So he was there at the festival. He saw Sparsh, liked it very much. And he said, I would like to meet you. So we were staying at the Hotel Rossiya in Moscow at the time. And opposite Hotel Rossiya was a very delightful park, the Gorky Park. So we there. So Gul and I, after breakfast, we went to Gorky Park, and it's a huge park. We were walking around the park, and he told me why he wanted to see me. He said, I want you to make a film for me. I have recently turned to production. He had produced Khatta Meetha, which had become quite successful with Ashok Kumar and Pearl Padamsi and so on. So he said, after Khatta Meetha, the production bug has bitten me, and I would love to make a film, and I would like you to take the reins of the production, direction, writing, especially, so on. So I said, lovely, I'd like to do that. He said, do you, but I don't want a serious. He was only in for comedies. He said, I just want a comedy. I don't want a, can, do you have any script at hand? And as luck would have it, I did. You know, I had produced Sparsh originally for Doordarshan Delhi, and I had also produced another play, another teleplay called Dhuan Dhuan, you know, and that again had been uproariously successful in Delhi. It was a tale, a very silly story about three college buffoons who do nothing at all about as to what they're supposed to be doing, but they're fooling around, smoking, chasing girls, and doing everything that they shouldn't be doing, and having a gala time. So it was about basically the irresponsibility of the student section, certain genre of student section, let's say. But it was a fun film, basically. All three chaps were good for nothing. So I told Gul the story in short, and Gul said, it's a delightful idea, and but he said, we can't have all three of them buffoons, you know, one of them has to be solid, serious, and, you know, well-meaning, and you have to show him, because he'll be our hero. We can't have a buffoon as a hero. So can you do that? Can you change it? I said, well, I'm a writer. I think I can do that. Yeah, sure. So he said, okay, what we'll do is, today is the so-and-so of the month, whatever the date was, I forget. But he said, exactly within 1 month, I will call you at your house in Bombay, And will you have the script ready by then? I said, no big deal, certainly. Of course, 1 month is nothing. I'll have the script ready. And so we parted. And I did nothing at all, you know. Because I don't know why I thought that film people, you know, they just make big promises and nothing comes of it. And here I'm going to toil and write a script afresh. And then he may not even turn up and all my labor will be for nothing and so on and so forth. So in my wisdom, I did nothing at all. And then come one the bit of our understanding and I get a call from Gul. Is the script ready? And I was so ashamed and I was so crestfallen. And I said, no, Gul, not quite. Can you give me 1 more week? And I'll definitely have it ready for you. He said, well, okay, but don't delay it more. I said, no question for any further delay. So I put the phone down and picked up my pen and started writing. And sure enough, I had it ready now within a week. And he loved the concept, he loved the script, but he kept on suggesting, he's a blue-blooded producer. He said, look, this is now just for youngsters. But we want their mothers to come and see the film. We want their uncles and aunts to come and see the film. We even want their grandparents to come and see the film. So add a mother figure, add a older brother, add something there, that. So I would say, yeah, okay. And I would try to accommodate his requests. And then one day I snapped. I said, well, I feel like a baniya, you know, not like a script writer. You know, I feel like a baniya doing this. He said, no, Sai, you will later thank me for it, which I did incidentally. And because Lallan Mia, the Panwala, was introduced because of Gul, you know, and so on, all these characters. And suddenly we had a full-fledged story. And then we hunted for the actors. And we had this film going. And then in that, of course, it was a funny film and a silly film. So I had this concept of having a fun song, Chitrahar kind of a thing, you know, taking all the known songs of Hindi cinema. One of the characters, this hero, Farooq Sheikh, and his two buddies, one is Ravi Baswani, and one is Rakesh Bedi. And the three of them, you know, kick up a riot. So we had these characters and I wrote a sequence where one of the, all have a bet as to who is going to woo Deepti Nawal. They see her passing the house and they have a bet as to who's going to befriend her first and who is going to try to, you know, call her out and so on and so forth. So this is Ravi Baswani's version. He goes to her house and he's a big shot, hot shot in the film world in Bombay. And he's given a thrashing by her brother who can see through him and who knows he's a good for nothing fellow. So and now he can't come back to his room and share this humiliation with his friends. So he cooks up a yarn about how he was fantastically impressive and how he floored the girl, etc. So that is what we can see now. Nikita, if you will show us the song which Ravi Baswani and Deepti present.
काफी संजीदा कहानी है. वैसे आप एक्टिंग में इंटरेस्टेड हैं? मैं दिल्ली टैलेंट स्काउटिंग के लिए आया हूँ.
बंबई से दिल्ली?
हाँ. दरअसल जया जी के बाद बड़ा वैक्यूम आ गया है इंडस्ट्री में. अगर आप चाहे तो.
ओह फिलिंग, मैं तो खुद मुंबई आने की सोच रही थी.
अगर मैं आपका स्क्रीन टेस्ट ले लूं तो आप इनकार तो नहीं करेंगी?
करना था इनकार मगर इकरार, तुही से कर बैठे नाना करते प्यार, तुही से कर बैठे प्यार किया कोई चोरी नहीं की, छुप छुप आहे भरना क्या जब प्यार किया तो डरना क्या, प्यार किया तो डरना क्या जब प्यार किया तो डरना क्या.
हम छोड़ चले हैं महफिल को, याद आए कभी तो मत रोना, इस दिल को तसल्ली दे लेना, घबराए कभी तो मत रोना, हम छोड़ चले. हम चले आए दिल हथेली पर ले आए रे तुमने बुगारा
Quite a gentle parody on some of these well-known numbers, I must say. Okay, so now I just want to ask you, should we speak a little more about Papiha and so on? Or would you like to say, you know, I think it might be interesting for people to know a little bit about Papiha because you discovered forest life in a way which was very original. So probably those kind of forests don't even exist today in India. But at the time you were there and a kind of tribal forest life which you discovered and the forest itself.
Well,
say a little bit about
Papiha
that.
Papiha was really a revelation, the film, though it's not very well known. Not too many people have seen it. Unfortunately, it didn't get a proper producer. The producer was me. And so one couldn't do justice. But I thought of the story when I read about Sundar Lal Bhaguna's magnificent achievement, you know, and the Chipko movement and so on. And I said, something really has to be, this has to be taken further on, and it has to be, everyone has to be made aware of it. And I decided to write a film which talked of our forests and our tribals. And in fact, I said, let me try a love triangle. And the hero was a forest officer, one part of the angle. The other angle was the heroine who was a social anthropologist doing tribal research. So she has come to forest to do tribal research. And the third angle was the forest itself, because both these people love forest. So the forest officer and the anthropologist. This was my triangle. And I built a story. It was like, I called it a fairy tale for adults. So it was not tremendously realistic. I took certain liberties, but it was given a fairy tale treatment. And even the narrator was a tribal, Gudang Baba, we called him. And he has a band of kids, 5-6 children, and they are constantly roaming around. They're constantly walking through the forest. And he is telling them the story. And this is the story of the king is the forest officer, the queen or the princess is the social anthropologist, and so on and so forth. So the story unravels, and it was a very exciting time, because I think I nearly spent one whole year in the forests of Maharashtra. And I went to all the possible forests in Maharashtra and did tribal research and did a research of the trees and the various trees, Tendua and Sag and all the, now I forget all the names, but you know, at one time they were at the tip of my fingers. And it was really Mahua and so on. And And a lot of people helped in this project. For one thing, Anand Maslekar, who at that time was a chief of the Maharashtra Forest Carrier, he opened all doors for us, and we were allowed to shoot anywhere in any Maharashtra forest and given a blank check, absolutely. We were even put up in various guest houses, forest guest houses, and I was given an expert from his department to be our guide and to explain things to us. And it was really fabulous. But what was very exciting and very strange was when we came across the tribals, you know, the kind of lives they led and the kind of beliefs they had and the humanity and the love and the warmth that they wanted to share with us, it was mind-blowing. It was something I could never have dreamt about, you know, sitting in Bombay or Pune. So one day I remember we went to a tribal hut and there was a chula right inside the hut and the pot was bubbling, boiling on the chula. And the lady of the house very sweetly smiled and she said, "Will you have lunch with us? It's just getting ready." And she lifted the lid and inside were two rats cooking. And I had to really put all my histrionic talents to the test to not show my horror or my shock or my whatever. So I, as if I had rats for lunch every day, I said, "No, today I'm afraid I've just had my lunch and I've come, but some other time I'd love to share your meal, and today you'll have to," etc., etc. And Mukund Dixit, who was one of our guides and who was an expert in forest affairs and tribal affairs, when we came out, he said, "You were magnificent." He said, "I thought you were going to puke, you know, when you saw the rat." I said, "No, no, I wouldn't ever do that to her." And, you know, so all kinds of things. And then, one day we went and two of our tribal fellows who were our escorts, you know, they stuck their sticks, their rods in two rat holes, you know, and put their arms right in. And I was a bit scared. I said, maybe it's a snake thing or something. But they pulled their hands out and it was full of rice and wheat. And they said, "Dekha, ye chuhe sale hamara anaj churate hain. These silly rats steal our grain and then we have to take it back from them." So all kinds of funny things, you know, very, very quaint. And we had a lot of tribal actors also acting. One funny thing I must share with you, we had the tribals just wear nothing, loincloths, that's it, langotis, you know. So we got stacks and stacks and yards of poplin in Bombay before setting out, because I said we must have nice long langotis for all the men that we have. And wherever we went, we traveled all over Maharashtra, you know, from Dahanu to Bhamragar to Nagjira to all the forests we traveled. And wherever we went, we had our own tribals, in the sense actors pretending to be tribals, about 5-6 of them, really good actors. But when we went to a particular new place, we got the local tribals to be the masses and to be part of the group. And so when the newcomers came from the village, we gave them langotis naturally, and they were thrilled to have these chaka chaka langotis in there. But what happened was, after the day's shooting was over, they vanished with their costumes, you know. They never returned their dresses, and our dress man was distraught. He said, "What do I do now in the middle of a forest? You know, we are running short of langotis." So he said, "Okay, I'll cut them." So each langoti became two langotis, you know, and we made do with that. And then much later, when someone saw the film, one very astute spectator said, "Can you explain one thing? In some scenes..." Okay. So anyway, that's the short of it. But okay, I think we can end it now. I think enough.
Okay. So would you like to say anything?
It's very frustrating to be constantly jitta hoti.
So would you have any last words? Would you like to say something?
Can you wind up? Huh?
Yes, I can wind up. I can say that Sai Paranjpye, you last but
yes, I would. I'm often asked by very well-meaning
Go on.
I'm often asked in my press reviews, press meetings, as to what message. Just read I'll read a little bit from my preface. You know, it'll give a very nice rounding of. Just give me half a minute. Yeah. Okay. I was always asked by press people, how would you rate your play as a tool of social awareness? I've always been wary of aphorisms and have stayed away from heavy cogitation, such as mass enlightenment, civic upliftment, ethical teaching, and moral awakening. Who has given me the responsibility of safeguarding the moral health of my fellow beings? Who am I to be mouthing platitudes and preaching? I certainly never envisaged myself in the role of a modern day Aesop. If my work can bring a smile to somebody's face or get someone to forget his woes for a spell, I've achieved my goal. I believe in the power of entertainment. It is my conviction that the people brought up on a regime of healthy, robust entertainment are happy and contented. So, I can claim without reservation that my creative journey has been a long and a very happy pilgrimage.
Thank you, Sai. Thank you.
Thank you, Sai. Very much. Sai, chan hota award la. Mohini, please take over.
Thank you. Lovely.
Wow. Mohini, please take over.
That was beautifully said. Absolutely fabulous. Now, you know, we have had technical glitches in the past, but never of such dimension. So this has been such a pity, such a great pity. Yeah. It's one of those things that you can't blame anyone for. They happen. And I'm so sorry.
I'm very sorry for you, Mohini. I know how you've been looking forward to this.
She was indeed. She was indeed.
Yeah, in spite of everything, yeah, and in spite of the fact that we couldn't cover all the ground that we wanted to, I know Latika and Aneeta had so much more to ask. So you had so much scope to say so much more. But nevertheless, let me say that even this much has been wonderful. It has been great, you know, having this interface with you.
I'm almost touched.
In the flesh, that's what I can say. And wonderful hearing from you,
thank you.
Directly.
Thank you.
I've been a great fan of yours. I will make this. You know, the films are, you know, such good, clean fun and such a healthy lesson. And so introspective on the right is all of the above. I mean, this has been a wonderful reminder of this fabulous journey that you have gone. And I know that I haven't seen the whole of your journey. I've seen the movies and, the plays like Sakhi Shezari and all that. But I'm sure I haven't seen each and everything. But now I've read the book and I know a little bit more about what you have done. And it's been fabulous. That's all I can say.
It has
been
fabulous
having you with us. Look upon this particular program as one of the highlights of the journey of the book club. Thank you, Sai. It has been, you have no idea. I mean, I can absolutely understand that you have been annoyed, you know, because it's broken your line of thinking and so on. Of course, I see that. But as I said, nevertheless, in spite of it all, it has still been wonderful.
May I just add one thing, Mohini? You may not know that all the things that she has done recently, such as write this, her memoir, Sai, Mazak Kala Pravas, and then translate it into English and translate Nasiruddin Shah's and then one day into Marathi. All this was done in longhand.
Oh, wow.
Thick books like this, all done in longhand, which no one does today, and she has been able to do it. And it does not end there. She continues.
Absolutely. In fact, I was going to say that next, but I'm eager to see what you're up to now. You know, what happens next? What's on the anvil? What do I look out for tomorrow?
Oh, we leave that thought to
yes, work. Yes, indeed. I leave that
thank
thought
you.
With you. Thank wonderful. You. And thank I would also like to thank Latika and Aneeta for managing this, for collaborating with Sai, you know, for organizing the whole thing. Thank you so much, both
thank
of you.
You. It's thank you, Moini. Thank you, Sai. Thank you.
Thank you. Good night.
Thank you very much.
All those people who came today, thank you also. Apologies for the technical glitches. What can we do and what can we say? We have to take them in our stride. That's all. And see at the end of the day what we have gained rather than what we have lost.
I think more we should end the day.
Yes, and we are ending it.
Tell everyone, Kali Ghodi Dwara Khadi. Your Kali Ghodi is waiting for you at your gate. So let's close shop and you go to meet your colleague Ghodi and go home. Okay.
Okay. So on the 24th of July, the book club will meet you with Munira Kheraluwala talking about Rabindranath Tagore. Okay. All the best, everyone. Bye.